Sometimes it's easy to forget that building a model is not actually the end of the story. It's really where it really starts, because now you need to put this into production. You need to integrate the predictions, for example, with other pieces of your infrastructure, and then you need to make sure that the model stays current and then is not getting worse over time. And this is really what the whole model ops solution of RapidMiner is for. So let's get started with the basics first. Let's start with the deployments. I will show you how to deploy a model, what kind of different model types are there. So like we call them champions and or active models and challengers. How you can see how this model was created. Again, this is really important for compliance reasons, and well, how you really work with the model ops in overall. Okay, so like we've seen before with turboprep and auto model, here's another perspective or view here at the top, which is called deployments. And I already have one deployment in here in this location. You can have multiple deployment locations. Let's ignore this for now. I will come back a little bit later to this one here. Let's add a new one and let's call this one arrival delays. Okay, so we will generate this new deployment, and if we do this, we can see that we still only have one active deployment here. This is not active yet, nor could be activated because there are actually no models in this deployment. But I can click on it and we can see, yep, no models, not good. So let's go back to auto model then. And let's take those two models we have created before. You remember the linear model and the deep learning model, those have been pretty good. And let's deploy it. And all you need to do is click this button here. You can change the name if you like, you can pick the location. And then, yep, here's our new deployment. Let's add our model to this. So this will take a couple of seconds, and what's happening now in the background is that we're not just deploying the model, but we are also generating all the necessary workflows and processes for integrating the model into other IT systems, for checking if the model is still working, for collecting all the information and data about the models, and this is all happening while we deploy this model. That's why it takes a few moments. But after it's done, we will see that we have our first model in this deployment, in this new deployment. And since it's the first one, it automatically became the active model. So let's add another one and see what happens then. Again, it doesn't matter where you click. Let's deploy the deep learning model here. And if we do this, we add it to the same deployment, we will see that the second model will become the challenger model. So what is the idea behind active models and challenger models? Well, the active model is the one which produces the predictions whenever you use the model for or the deployment for scoring. No matter if you upload some data and do the scoring that way, or if you actually use the automatically created web services, the active model is the one which produces those predictions. But all the challengers are producing the predictions as well. They are just not delivered, but they can still be used to calculate how well those challengers perform. And you'll see this later in this demonstration that this can be very useful, because if this challenger becomes better over time, all you need to do is click here and change this one to the active model to replace it. Finally, we can also see the details of each model. So I can click on this model, I can see the model which has been generated. I see a snapshot of the full input data, and that actually is really important, because this input data here is not just a reference, it's a full copy. And why is that important? Because otherwise the data could have been changed in the meantime. But if you need to prove how this model has been built, think about GDPR in Europe, for example, and the right to explanation. You better know all the details without having any option that anybody could have been changing anything in the meantime. All the other results have been produced as well, and you can explore them here. And that even includes the generated process here. You can load this back into the design view. Well, that's not very exciting because it's pretty much the same process as the one we have seen before. But again, you can really prove how this model has been created. When we're talking about scoring, we also need to talk about how to explain the predictions a machine learning model is doing. I mean, for some models, it's really easy. Like for a decision tree, you can pretty much follow along as a human being. But for most models, it's just not, especially for the more powerful ones. And let's be honest, I sometimes ask people if they understand how exactly a regression model is working, and most people wouldn't know that either. So the whole topic of explainable AI became really important, and we at RapidMiner totally believe in a complete no black boxes policy. And that means for both. It's for how the models have been generated. So we saw this before, we can always open up the processes, but it's also about the predictions which are created by the models. So let's have a look into how those predictions are created, and what you call it, the scoring, how we can explain those predictions. We have been showing those model-specific but model-agnostic weights before. And then there's another thing we call the model simulator. I personally like a lot, actually, and many of our users do too. Okay, so here's our two deployments again. For now, let's actually switch over to this one here because we just have a little bit more data already in this one here. It's a little bit more interesting. So let's go into the flight delays deployment here. Ignore the dashboard for now. We will come back to this later, but I will go into the scoring here. So there's two ways. One is we can do create scores by integrating this deployment into or this model into other systems via web services. We will discuss this later. Or you can just upload some data like this. So for example, today is the October 3rd, the day I'm producing this year. So I thought let's take the 2008 data. So remember, we trained the model in 2007. Now we take the 2008 data also from October 3rd, and we load it in. So here's the date. We're not using the arrival time or arrival delay, obviously, but we detected that we have this tart column already. And if we have this, it's kind of useful because then we can calculate error rates right away. Okay, so let's feed this data in here. Let's do the scoring. And after a couple of moments, we will get all the predictions together with the confidence values and also the explanations like the ones we have seen before. We are using a faster variant of the so-called LIME algorithm for local explanations here. It's faster, so it even works in real time. We'll see this in the simulator a little bit later. And it delivers you those supporting and contradicting colors like we have seen before. So for every prediction, so most flights are on time, here's one is delayed, you see exactly what was driving this prediction. And as I mentioned before, columns which are in general a little bit bolder support most of the predictions or contradict most of those predictions. Those are the columns which often have a higher model-specific weight. In this case, we knew the actual value already. If that is not the case, you can also define the actual outcomes for given IDs, which is really helpful to calculate those error rates we see a little bit later here as well. So let's move to the simulator. Before we do this, we see in general those delay columns are a little bit more important. We don't need those scores any longer, so let's just throw them away. So this simulator, what this is doing is we see the input factors on the left side, and then we see how the model behaves on the right side. And just by playing around, it really can be helpful to understand how the model works. So we saw the delays are important. We see this here as well. If I just increase the delay here, for example, in real time, you see how the model behavior is changing and also what is driving those predictions. Again, those local explanations are seen here as well. You can even turn this into prescriptive analytics. For example, if the flight already started late, but I want to do my best to actually bring it back to an on-time flight, what can I do? I can run this optimization here now, which is then telling me how would I need to change certain input factors to bring this back into an on-time flight as good as possible. So after this optimization is done, I can press the finish button here, and then the optimal values are taken over here. And as we can see, yeah, we still have a chance to bring this back to an on-time flight. How can we do this? Pretty much the only thing I compare this to the average is by bringing the taxi out and taxi in times here to pretty much zero. Well, let's better make sure that we get a gate close to the place where we are landing then, because otherwise it's getting even worse. That's the only thing we really can do then at that point in time. I mean, bad news. Let's now turn our attention over to the model management aspect of it. So sometimes you actually have been building models on a certain data set, and then after some time, the performance gets worse and worse. This is often a result of changes in the world, and you can detect this by looking into the drift of the inputs, meaning how different are the inputs now than they used to be. And then there's another element to this, like sometimes you're using information or not using information you should have been using or not have been using. And that leads to some bias in the selection of your input data. And there are really two sides of the same coin, actually. But if you want to do ethical data science, often you need to avoid this form of bias. So you should be very aware of this. So this section will show you how to identify those input drifts, how to do this bias detection, and also explore the differences in the different tools. All right, so let's start with our deployment again. The first indicator often already is in this models tab. So if you just compare the recent error with what you expected when you trained the model, you can see that in for the fast large margin, which is a linear model, it is a little bit worse, but not as much worse. While for the deep learning model, while it started very good, it's no longer that good. So there's probably some drift happening, and that's very typical for deep learning models as well, because they're just not very robust against changes against the world. So this is one way to see this. But then there's an extra tab up here, we call this drifts, where we show you for each input, like what are the inputs where there's the biggest differences. So for example, remember this column we have created, this total flights column? So between the training data, the dark greenish here, and the scoring data, we can see that overall there seems to be less flights now in 2018 going into Boston. So there was a bit of a change. That's actually the biggest change. This column is not super important, but still. And you can do the same for nominal columns like this one here. Again, like we talked about bias before, so overall the differences are not that big. But here's, for example, a couple of new flights coming now in from a state which wasn't existing before. And that can again also be an indicator for bias, because maybe you trained the model on cases, or you didn't train the model of case because you left out maybe complete geography or something like that. Input drift can be a problem. It doesn't have to be. So for example, this is the one we have seen before, the total flights here, going back to this one. But it luckily is not a very important column, so it's further here, the bottom left. But this really important one, the NAS delay, pretty much behaves the same, so it's not a problem. You really want to avoid any columns in this upper right corner here. So it's good that we can highlight those drift problems or potential bias problems here. Obviously, in combination with being able to see the details, how the models have been created, you remember from before, that really together can help you to figure out if there was a bias problem, if it's just a drift problem, and maybe retrain the model or take other measures if needed. Let's now dive even deeper into model management. I mentioned already before that with RapidMiner, you can actually close this feedback loop. So you can upload those actual outcomes, or you can use a web service for that. You will see this in a couple of minutes. Closing this feedback loop is really essential, because if you know the actual outcome at a later time, after you created the prediction and everything, you can then do backtesting and you can do proper model comparisons. So I will show this to you, and then the deployment dashboards, the leaderboards among the models. We have seen some of this already before, and we focus a little bit more on this performance dashboard here, which also can help you to understand the business impact of the models. Okay, so let's start with the dashboard. Here we see a couple of main KPIs, like how many scores did we generate so far, what's the total gains. This is orange line down here, so like how much did we generate here so far, like what's the error rate, are there any alerts going on right now, and so on. So each bar is for the number of scores we have created so far. So that is this, and the purple line shows you the average error rate, so it looks pretty stable over time. We already saw the model tab before, so let's focus on the performance then. The performance show even more details here. So again, we will see the scores for each model, but we also can see the error rates for the different models. So here we can see, okay, well, yeah, we generated a couple of scores every day. Overall, while our deep learning model is doing a half decent job, our fast large margin model actually becomes better now. So it's probably about time now to turn this over and make this the active model. But it comes as a price. It is a little bit slower for scoring than the deep learning model, in fact. So you can see the different distributions here for the actual classes, which again could be another indicator for potential drift here if the world has changed. In this case, it's more likely to be an outcome of the different cost matrices we have been or costs we have defined before. And talking about costs, here the purple area here, that is the best option without any models. So always going with on time. We saw this already in the order model. So here we can see what is the impact really over time. If we wouldn't use any model, like, well, we would make roughly 20 million here in over the course of the last 30 days. We can always change the time frame here. The turquoise one then is what the model delivers on top of it. So as we can see, it's almost 30 million in this case. And this difference between those two areas, that's how we calculate the gain, which is the orange curve here, which is then almost 9 million for this time frame. And that's important for making the case for your model to make sure the model is still delivering value. And it's not about accuracy, it's not about error rates, it's really about that and pretty much nothing else. All right, moving on to the last part, which is about model operations. Model operations is really about automating all the maintenance of around deployed models. So creating alerts, being aware that something is no longer working as it should, integrating the models into other pieces of your IT infrastructure. This is really what this next section is going to be about. So let's just jump right into this. Yeah, we have seen this before. Let's move over to the alerts tab here. And you can see that I already created three different alerts here. The first one is the drift alert. If this drift is greater than, let's say, 8% for the last week, and I check this once per day, then let's send an email to data scientist number 7. And the same is true for error alert, or if you have less than 100 scores on any given day, then again, we send out an email. Whenever an alert is triggered, we can see what has been triggered down here until we acknowledge this. So at this moment, this explains why we have the 7 alerts here. And if I, for example, acknowledge all of them, then this KPI would actually go back to 0 here and everything is green. So let's go back to our alerts and let's trigger a new one. Check now. This error alert will be checked at this moment. Is the error rate higher than what was it? 4%. Yes, it was almost 7%. Okay, so this has triggered. And I can just check my email inbox here, or actually, it's in fact data scientist number 7's email inbox, and I will get notified. So, this is about alerts. Integrations is equally simple. You can see the URL for the web service here. I run this on a local server right now, and you can test this for some of those values. You just test the web service here. What is nice, I get all the results here in JSON, but we support actually more than 30 different output formats here, so you can change this if you like. So you get all this information here. We even can deactivate the deployment, and that means the web server would still respond, but it gives you a proper error message telling the system integrating this web service that currently the deployment is deactivated. And then there's the second web service here for defining the actuals. And with that, I would like to wrap this platform demonstration. We really managed to do a full project on flight delays. It's a full AI project. We learned a lot about our data. We created a predictive model. We put it into production. We managed this model. You saw it's all very simple, but it also at the same time stays very transparent. And I said it before, RapidMiner is the only platform supporting everything from data prep, automated machine learning, down to model ops in this augmented and automated way. But there is this whole other piece to the platform that you can actually see what exactly has happened in with those annotated processes, which comes in very useful and is often very important also for compliance reasons. Thanks for staying with me for that whole hour here, and I hope you enjoyed it as much as I did. Thanks a lot.